Everybody, good to see all of you on behalf of the Clements Center for National Security and the UT's Intelligence Studies Project. I'm honored to welcome you to the latest installment in our ongoing academic year speaker series. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Will M. Bowden, the Executive Director of the Clements Center. And I'm honored to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Angelo Codevilla. And we just clarified that since he is a native of Italy, and even though he is in Texas, where when we see V-I-L-L-A, we say Via. True to the motherland, it is Codevilla. Angelo, we've had a lot of interesting speakers over the years with interesting backgrounds, but this guy may well take the cake yet. So he is a native of a small town in northern Italy who, enchanted by the allure of the American West and the American dream, migrated with his mother to the United States at age 13, where he then pursued a really singular career across a range of fields. He was a foreign service officer with the Department of State. He served for 7 years as a senior professional staff member on the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence during some very tumultuous times with the Carter and Reagan administration and some very consequential legislation and measures that were passed. He is a very accomplished scholar as well. He taught at Stanford for 10 years, taught at Boston University for a number of years, has published a staggering array of books on a range of topics. And I could just stop right there and call him up and we'd have an interesting discussion. But I can't let this this chance escape to highlight, of all the speakers we've had, he is really the first one ever who also owns and operates and makes his own winery and makes Codevilla wine from Northern California. So, you know, we've had some big shots here. We had Jim Comey here last week. Jim Comey is great. Jim Comey didn't give me a bottle of Comey Cabernet, all right? But I do have here a bottle of Codevilla Torriga, right?
Torriga,
that's right, a Portuguese grape. Available at a fine wine merchant near you. I don't know if Twin Liquors here is or not. No, it really is. It's a great boutique winery, but we shared a bottle the other night, and it is delicious. So now Angelo is not here to talk to us about the differences between New World and Old World winemaking techniques, although during Q&A he's happy to take up anything. He's going to talk to us about the much more pressing topic of the role of intelligence in American national security. Specifically, shall we use intelligence with a capital I or intelligence with a small I, or maybe a little bit of both? So please join me in welcoming Angelo Codevilla.
It's natural that most of the questions will be coming about the current mess in Washington concerning intelligence. I will entertain them, especially because I was involved in some of the legislation that is now in question. I want to put all of that in the context of the way that American intelligence is structured, to make the point that the troubles that you constantly hear about concerning American intelligence are structural. They are not accidents. They simply occur and recur because of the way things are set up. And the main problem, the main structural feature which makes them crop up this way is what the confusion between intelligence, i.e. the searching out of detail, of secret details about the world, and understanding the world so as to operate efficiently in its regard. The U.S. intelligence system as it exists today is unique in the world in blending these two things. That is because historically intelligence has been the function of operations, government operations, whatever they be, primarily military operations. Military commanders have always sought to find out what the enemy was going to do next, here, there, what the ground was like in areas where operations would take place. Things absolutely necessary to operations as they will be conceived. The Department of State has, like every other diplomatic establishment in the world, has always assigned its, given as its primary assignment to its envoys abroad, reporting on current conditions. Long ago, in Renaissance times, ambassadors were seen as a kind of spy. Well, spy in what sense? Well, yes, perhaps in the sense of learning who the king's favorites were and all of that, but above all, as reporters of what things are like out there. These things are, as a foreign service, foreign service officer, I can tell you that that is what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to report just what's it like over there. Who's, not just who's who, but you know, what is the climate of opinion? What is considered important, unimportant? How do things work? You who have not been there, who read the reports from the people who are there, find out what it's like. This has nothing to do with intelligence as it's normally understood, suborning, treason, getting some sort of detail. Now, the basic point is that unless you have that intelligence in the lower case, which comes from a natural understanding of the world in which you live and of the subject that you are contemplating, the details, the secret details ferreted out, are likely to confuse you. You will quite literally be looking through a keyhole and seeing a tail and imagining it's perhaps a donkey, whereas in fact you're looking at an elephant. You see, you have no idea that it's an elephant. Why? Because you're seeing just through that keyhole. Looking through a keyhole is dangerous. Give you a concrete example. What's it like when you don't understand the bigger picture? Henry Kissinger negotiated for years with the Soviets concerning missiles. He didn't know the head or the tail of a missile or what these things were for, nor did he particularly care what these things, exactly how these things worked. He was negotiating, even directly, with a man named Brezhnev. Brezhnev, who had been assigned as the political commissar of the missile forces by Joseph Stalin many, many years ago. That man had grown up with missiles, knew exactly what they were for. And so, whereas the distinction between counterforce and countervalue mattered nothing at all to Henry Kissinger, it mattered everything to Brezhnev. Whereas Kissinger was content to take the size of silos and the number of silos as indicative of the military power of these missiles, and therefore was content to accept the SALT I treaty to present it to the Senate as the end of the arms race. He didn't understand that what he had just done was to give to the Soviet Union a clear shot to win it without being contested. He had a great deal of intelligence about the things that he wanted concerning Soviet missiles, but he didn't understand what those meant, you see. So that's a concrete example of the danger that you get into when you don't have the intelligence with a lowercase I as a background for the intelligence with an uppercase I. The U.S. intelligence system is unique in that with the creation of the Central Intelligence Agency, it divorced the gathering of intelligence with the uppercase I from responsibility for operations. When commanders, or military commanders, or chiefs of state would ask questions of their intelligence people concerning the world, they would do so with the intention of, in fact, carrying certain operations to completion, victory, or some sort of advantage. The Central Intelligence Agency, however, was created to gather information about the world, lots of it, all of it, including, by the way, open source information, and to make it available to whomever in the U.S. government would find it useful. Well, that was a daunting task, because who could know what the uses to which it might be put? Would there be a means for focusing this collection, this gathering of stuff, and the analysis thereof, on topics most interesting to the user? Of course there would be, the so-called intelligence requirements, and the military services, the president's office itself would funnel these requirements in to the Central Intelligence Agency. And what does it do with them? Well, it applies to these things such resources as it has. In other words, what you've got is a classic producer-dominated system. You go to the store, and you have no control over what the store has or does not have. You're not a consumer whose desires drive the industries. Here, when you go to buy a car and you don't find what you want there, and you don't buy the car, you're telling the dealers and ultimately the auto industry what kind of car you do want, or at least what kind of car you don't want. But if you're an intelligence consumer, and you go to the CIA and you say, well, I'd like to know this about that, and they say, well, we're doing our best with what we've got. But they are not saying, and I have no desire or capability to say, oh, we will change who we are in order to provide you with what you want. The automakers will change what they are doing to provide you what you want. The Central Intelligence Agency will not say, well, the human intelligence officers we have are not providing the right stuff on the Soviet Union because they can't get in there. They can't get next to the people they should get next to because, well, for a variety of reasons. And by the way, they can't even get half as close to the purveyors of terrorism. We'll do the best we can of what we've got, and so here it is. So these are the problems with a producer-dominated system, a system which is inherently unresponsive to demands. And what happens when the intelligence requirements, when there's not enough information out there for the intelligence requirements to be met? Well, two things happen, both of which are unhealthy. One is, well, since we don't really know the answer, the facts for the answer, what we're going to do is substitute our opinions for the fact. We will take our opinions. Opinions are easy to formulate, quite cheap. Facts are often impossible to find. Opinions are easy to formulate. And we will say, we believe that this is the case. And if someone then asks you, well, on what basis do you believe them? You say, ah, the facts are way too secret for me to share with you. if you had available to you the information that is available to us, you would agree with us. But unfortunately, we just can't tell you. So, you know, just go ahead and believe us. So that's one of the effects. And by the way, the most common statement in intelligence documents is, we believe. And in fact, just to cut to the chase, the revelations, so-called revelations, concerning the Trump administration's contacts with the Russians, all have to do with, we believe, we have high confidence that. On what is your confidence based? Well, we can't tell you that. This is not unusual. This is standard. This is what happens. That's one of the things that happens. The other thing that happens is, in a way, in its own way, just as deleterious, and that is that lacking the proper sources, the incentive is to use such sources as are available, and not to care too terribly much just how much the other side may be tampering with those sources, or how reliable those sources are. Let me give you one example, which is unfortunately incontrovertible. Once upon a time, we had a nice satellite, a geosynchronous orbit, which we called Chalet, and then later on we called it Vortex and other things. In those days, those names were top secret code word. And then two things happened. A fellow by the name of Geoffrey Prime, working in British intelligence, betrayed that satellite in one way, possibly compromising it. And then the coup de grace was given to the satellite by the New York Times when Richard Burt published a story on it on the front page. So the satellite was compromised. When the time came to reauthorize money for it, yours truly and some others struck the satellite from the budget. The agency came in and said, "Ah, no, we've got to have it. And I said, "But the Soviets know all about it. What's the use?" And he said, "Well, it's the only source we've got of conversations going from west to east along the corridor that has the ballistic missiles." "Yeah, I know, it's the only source you've got, but it's a compromised source." "Well, it's the only source we've got and we want it." Argued with the senator. The senators believed us on the staff that this was, this was nonsense. To keep it, to spend that money. To get what? To get compromised information. But then the contractors chimed in. And it was a matter of a couple of $100 million. And even back then, that was money, So the satellite continued to be used and continued to feed compromised information. Which leads to the point that, if you were to ask, what precise purpose would such information serve? What would you do with it? What would you do with it that would advance the interests of the United States? Well, there wasn't any good answer to that. But there was an answer to a similar question concerning another set of data that was coming from another highly compromised source. For over a decade, the head of counterintelligence for the Soviet East European Division, CIA, was working for the Soviet Union, and therefore all of the stuff that was coming over our agent network was in fact manufactured by the KGB. It was a wonder to me at the time that this was not recognized, because it was such variance to the. This is while the Soviet Union was collapsing, while Gorbachev was running his experiment with regard to the structure of the Soviet state. Glasnost, perestroika, he called it, whatever he called it, it was certainly highly disruptive. And if you read the excellent reporting of the New York Times at the time, you got the impression that Gorbachev was an idiot and he was wrecking the Soviet Union. If, however, you read the stuff coming in from our agent network, you read that Gorbachev was a canny reformer who was steering the Soviet Union along the path of westernization. The State Department, by the way, was reporting the same thing that the New York Times was reporting. But the compromised network was essentially giving the message, support Gorbachev, support Gorbachev. Of course, the KGB was essentially writing those stories. Well, what happened to those reports? My opinion at the time was that the reports people at CIA were stupid. They didn't understand. I was wrong. As it turns out, they did understand that they had a very, very strong sense that this stuff was compromised. It was too far away from intelligence with a lowercase I. But what did they do? They continued to pass it up the line to the president because they believed this, according to the Inspector General of CIA, they believed that this point of view was one that the president should heed, that it was a good idea for the president to follow. So, what have you got here? You've got here a kind of basic corruption, a basic corruption that comes perhaps not so much from any individual's failing, but from a system which incentivizes those who run it, not so much to be the lookouts for the ship of state, but to be among those who grab for some control of the steering wheel. Again, this would not happen if the distinction between intelligence with a lowercase I and intelligence with a capital I, secret intelligence, particular intelligence, were maintained. And it is not, and indeed it should be. Part of this is manifested in the inattention, which is a good word for inattention, lack of attention, if not allergy, that the intelligence community has with regard to counterintelligence, meaning not at all security, but rather skepticism concerning one's own sources and awareness of the extent to which others know of your own operations and how they may tamper with them. Once upon a time, there was a small, within CIA, there was a small counterintelligence section, which although it did not have the power to negate any given source or operations therewith, did have the power to question that to the director. That was run by James Angleton, who was pilloried in the press by leaks. CIA is very good at leaking. As paranoid, et cetera, et cetera. I knew the man. He was certainly a highly skeptical man. That was his job. Paranoid? Well, I doubt it. Certainly, no one would have characterized that gentleman as that. He was simply asking inconvenient questions. And given, and now we get back to a fundamental point, what would happen to U.S. intelligence do skepticism about its sources exercised? What would happen is that an awful lot of questions to the intelligence community would have to be answered with, gosh, we don't really know. Well, then the policymakers would say, well, that's not what we're paying you all those millions and billions for. And of course, that's not what anybody wants to hear. And so an unhealthy cycle takes place in which everyone is playing around with pretend knowledge. Now, pretend knowledge can be terribly, terribly destructive. I'll give you an example. On December 30th, 2009, 9 CIA people were blown up by one of their sources in Khuds, Afghanistan. That man had been providing them information for about 18 months on the basis of which they had been targeting people and places in Afghanistan for U.S. drone strikes. We have no idea how many hundreds of people had been killed over those 18 months by those drone strikes. But we can be quite certain that none of those were enemies of the United States. Because, of course, this man, who in fact was a jihadist himself and very much an enemy of the United States, was in fact trying to do the United States harm. How had the agency come to rely on him to the point of getting the U.S. government to kill people on his say-so? Well, there he was. There they were, lacking their own sources in Afghanistan, just like they lacked their own sources regarding terrorism everywhere. And so they took what they could get. And what they could get was passed to them by Jordanian intelligence, for better or worse. And they had no independent means of verifying the sources bona fides. And so they took it, just like they took the Syrian government's interrogations of Abu Zubaydah as gospel. Why? Because they had no means other than to accept what they were given. And why did they have no alternative? Because they had no sources of their own. Why do they have no sources of their own? Because to even try to get sources of their own, they would have to have case officers other than the ones they've got. Because the ones they've got, people who look like me, and who actually speak far fewer languages than I do, have no means of getting close to these people. And besides, getting close to such people is dangerous. Very dangerous. And despite what you've heard about CIA people putting their lives on the line, that really doesn't happen voluntarily very often. a lot of the stars up on the building are people who have worked on contract with CIA. I know some of them. I knew some of them. One fellow who almost wound up there, and right now is very, very ill still because of his experience, was a U.S. Army captain, seconded to CIA for a very dangerous mission. Lots of people like that. That very person was also used for, because of his physical appearance and language capacity, was also used for a stakeout, a very dangerous stakeout. No case officer, you know, blooded case officer of the Central Intelligence Agency would be used in such a way. Working as a street peddler in Afghanistan, speaking pidgin Urdu and trying to get along for weeks on end in order to stake out a particular location. This is not what they do. And if you want an intelligence system that does that, you would have to have something other than the current cadre of people doing it. And if you wanted information, electronic information, other than what is than what we have from current systems, you would have to have those systems emplaced in places where it would be very dangerous to emplace them, very dangerous to emplace them. Enough said about that subject. So where do they emplace? Where does the effort end up? Well, the effort ends up with domestic, in domestic affairs and in wording estimates, papers, in a way that would be most striking politically, and then leaking them. This is not really called leaking, we're talking about officers, high-ranking officers, going directly to the offices of the Times or the Post and having conversations about these things and sharing papers. I will leave it at that. Let me just say one thing, because this is probably going to be your first question. In 1978, I was on the Intelligence Committee as we drafted the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. At the time, the American Civil Liberties Union wanted that law in order to extend the concept of probable cause to the process of wiretapping. And the intelligence agencies wanted that law in order to be pre-cleared for everything they did, so they could not be sued or otherwise criticized for whatever they did. They could simply say, this was court approved. Well, the drafters of the bill simply reconciled the two sets of desires and produced the bill. My criticism of it at the time was that what they were doing was legalizing the next Watergate. That the distinction in the bill between intended collection and accidental collection would be treated as a joke by those who ran it, and that the judges would not know the difference, could not know the difference. because the difference would be the actual choices made by those who actually did the operations. The result would be that the next time that somebody wanted to have sensitive information about, someone in power wanted to have some sensitive information about the a challenger, all they would have to do is get a couple of FISA warrants regarding so-called foreigners, and easily co-involve the truly intended targets. This is clearly what happened in the latest round. Well, all right. So I leave it at that and open to questions. I hope you will not concentrate exclusively on that subject, but I'm ready to get into the details if you like.